Teenagers. So I'm going to need all teenagers to definitely go and help in Children's Church. This is the grown folks only type experience. So thank you so very, very much for your willingness to help in Children's Church. I saw y'all already went out to be of assistance. So we want to make sure that we protect them as long as we can. Grown folks said amen. Amen. So we're in the series, our relationship rehab. This is now part three of the series. Last week we dealt with what to do before you say I do. Today's sermon deals a little bit with what happens after you said I do. If you have your Bibles or book of instruction before leaving earth, I invite your attention to the Song of Solomon. We're actually going to be in chapter number four. We're going to be in chapter number four of Song of Solomon. If you've not read the Song of Solomon, I encourage you to definitely read the Song of Solomon. We've shared in the past that this particular book was one that was debated as to whether it should even be included in the canon. And so the fact that it's there meant that God wanted us to get something out of it. So we definitely don't want to get over it in the preaching moment. We invite you to stand to under the reading of God's Word. If you have it on your iPhone, iPad, it's on the screen as well. If you've got a Bible that you're highlighting and putting notes in, we invite you to turn to Song of Solomon. You got it, say amen.
Amen.
Let's try this one more time. I need just to wake up a little bit and get engaged in service. If you got it, say amen.
Amen.
All right. Still looking, say, hold up, Song of Solomon. I'm actually going to read all of chapter number four. Again, if you remember it's on Solomon, just get ready for chapter number four. Here's what it says. I'm reading from the New American Standard Version. How beautiful you are, my darling. Paul, I want you to know this is after he said, I do. Chapter three is their wedding day. This is the reception you're reading about. Here he is. He whispers to his girl, how beautiful you are, my darling. How beautiful you are. Your eyes are like doves behind your veil. Your hair is like a flock of goats that have descended from Mount Gilead. Your teeth are like a flock of newly shorn ewes, which have come up from their washing, all of which bear twins. And not one among them has lost her young. Your lips are like a scarlet thread. Your mouth is lovely. Your temples are like a slice of pomegranate behind your veil. Your neck is like the Tower of David, built with rows of stones, on which are hung 1,000 shields, all around the shields of the mighty men. Your two breasts are like two fawns, twins of gazelle, which feed among the lilies. Until the cool of the day, when the shadows flee away, I will go my way to the mountain of mirth and to the hill of frankincense. You are altogether beautiful, my darling. There is no blemish in you. Come with me from Lebanon, my bride. May you come with me from Lebanon, journey down from the summit of Amon, from the summit of Shinar and Hermon, from the dens of lions, from the mountains of lepers. You have made my heart beat faster, my sister, my bride. You have made my heart beat faster with a single glance of your eyes, with a single strand of your necklace. How beautiful is your love, my sister, my bride. How much better is your love than wine, and the fragrance of your oils, than all kinds of spices. Your lips, my bride, drip honey. Honey and milk are under your tongue, and the fragrance of your garment is like the fragrance of Lebanon. A garden locked is my sister, my bride. A rock garden locked, a spring sealed up. Your shoots are an orchard of pomegranates, with choice fruits, henna, with nard plants, nard and saffron, calamos and cinnamon, with all the trees of frankincense, myrrh and aloes, along with the finest spices. You are a garden spring, well of fresh water, streams flowing from Lebanon. Awake, O north wind, and come, wind of the south. Make my garden breathe out fragrance. Let its spices be wafted aboard. May my beloved come into his garden and eat its choice fruits. This is the word of God for the people of God. The word of God is already blessed. And you put a smile on your face, like you're glad to be here, like God woke you up this morning, and you know you don't deserve it. A smile on your face. Just got my tax return, and I got more than I expected. I didn't owe them anything. Type smile on your face. Look at your neighbor and say, neighbor! Okay, y'all look back at me. Smile on your face. I need y'all to be happy and glad to be here. I didn't have to wake up this morning. God didn't have to be so good, so kind to you. So I need you really enthusiastically look at your neighbor and say, neighbor, good morning. Good to see you. Glad you're here. This morning, serving you. Love languages. Look at another neighbor. Look at another neighbor joyously and say, neighbor, good morning. Good to see you. Show magic. This morning, sermon is love language. You may be seated in the presence of God. Will you pray with me? Father, it's once again that I stand to proclaim your word. I pray, dear Lord, that I decrease and that you increase mightily, that these your people would see and hear less of me and more of thee. Take the words of my mouth and the meditations of my heart and make them to be acceptable in thy sight. Lord, our God, our strength, and our redeemer. Father, I have studied, but I need your strength. I have prepared, but I need your power. I'm willing and I want to, but I need you to make me able. Sally, now wait for me. Ready, my Lord, thy will to see. Open my eyes and lift me. God, prepare us to receive your word. In Jesus' name. Amen. I said at the beginning of this series that many of us who are in relationships are in need of relationship rehab solely because more often than not, we take our cues about relationships from what the world says. We are comfortable with coming to church and hearing about spiritual things, about how to pray, you know, how to read your Bible and how to love God, but you don't really want the church telling you about how to do what you do when you go home. And so I'm saying that if we're gonna seriously be disciples of Jesus Christ, then we ought to take our cues from what the Word of God says about even how we act in relationships. Today's sermon definitely helps us do that. Today's text helps us to do that. I'm not sure if you knew this or not, but men and women are different. Men and women are different. When it comes to getting going, when it comes to excitement, when it comes to being joyous in the occasion, being ready. Men are like a $2 clock that you buy from Dollar General. Don't take much to open it. The lock they, the keys they give you for the lock, a toothpick, anything can really open the lock. Don't take much for men to get going. Women, on the other hand, are like a cipher combination lock that's cryptographic in that the code changes every 4 hours. And so what code you use last week might not open it this week. And the brothers would have said, amen, amen. Here's an example of the differences. Men and women, we speak a different language. And early in January, I had to go to Louisville for 2 weeks. Y'all may remember that. I had to go for school. Now, being away from my wife 2 weeks is not comfortable. I don't like it. And in Louisville at that time, it was cold, so it made it even worse. Oh, boy, you know, I got my last 2 days. I got my mind ready. I can't wait to get off the plane, to go see Lady Ball. I don't want the children to be there. I'm ready to go. I've not seen my wife. I have not laid with my wife for 2 weeks. And I'm like, Hercules, I can't wait to get home. And so I get home, and I am ready to go. I'm sending her text messages and everything. I'm ready to go, and I want lingerie. I want chocolates. I want versions of 50 Shades of Grey. Listen, we grown, we married. Listen, I'm coming home and I've been gone for 2 weeks. I am ready to go. I'm the $2 thought. Woman, listen, it don't take much. I get to the house and I'm excited and I'm ready to go. And my wife says to me, let's go get something to eat. I don't want to eat. I'm not hungry. I've ate before I came here. Woman, I've been gone for 2 weeks. But my wife speaks a different language. You see, quality time matters for her. And so she is not $2 lot from Dollar General for her. She needs to see me and to conversate with me and to invest. And I was just ready to go. We speak different languages. Sometimes there's a disconnect in marriage and in relationships because of our different languages. Gary Chapman, associate pastor at Calvary Baptist in Winston-Salem, North Carolina, has a book called Five Love Languages. Hoping you all have taken a look at this before, Five Love Languages. And in his book, Chapman says there are at least five different love languages that people have. And so we're going to look at three of them today. Here's a list of five. He says affirmation, quality time. Another one is receiving gifts. Listen, in almost every relationship that involves love, it involves a spirit of giving. This love language requires a physical gift. If your wife has this, you can't just tell her that you love her. You better go buy something in a little blue box, sky blue box. You gotta invest in it. So that's receiving gifts. Another one is acts of service. And you know, if she doesn't cook every night of the week, and one act of service maybe that you cook twice per week, or change or oil, or you finally put the desk together from IKEA, it's acts of service. Another one is physical touch. And so we're gonna look at three of these today. A good marriage is going to be based on the Word of God and knowing what each other's love language is and doing the love language that your spouse requires. If you ever heard something like, "You don't act like you love me," and your response is a little bit like this, "I go to work every day and I make sure the bills are paid," that looks like love to me. All your response is like, "I gave you the children and my body is different now." That's love. Chances are you're speaking different languages. Today's text teaches married folk how to communicate with one another in ways that your spouse values. You remember in chapter 1 of Song of Solomon, we have a sister girl who doesn't feel all that great about herself solely because her brothers have forced her into work, and she says, "I don't feel like I've even taken care of my own body." Yet still, Solomon, I believe the brother here, he says to her, "Woman, you are beautiful. I see something in you." He makes her feel good about herself. Chapter number 2, we see that, remember, there's all kind of other women in the area who are singing songs as well. And she says stuff like, "I'm just one flower in a whole garden of flowers." And he says, "Sister girl, listen, I want you to understand, the rest of them thorns don't matter to me. You're the only one that I see." He makes her feel really good about herself. And then she says something like, "He is mine and I am his. We really do go together. He really does like me." Chapter number 3 is really their wedding day. It starts with her having a bad dream. If anybody's been married before, you know that going into the wedding, you're like, "I'm not really sure if this is the right thing." At the end of chapter 3, we see the wedding day. It's a great, opulent occasion. Now, we are in chapter 4. And in this text, brothers and sisters, we see three love languages at work. Now, it's believed this portion takes place on the wedding night. They're at their reception, at their banquet. And the brother leans over and begins to whisper in her ear. And the first thing we notice from what he says is the importance of words of affirmation. Say words,
words
of affirmation.
Of affirmation.
Verses 1-5, we see words of affirmation. He looks at her and he says to her, "Your eyes are like dove eyes behind your veil." Now, sisters, don't get mad. I know it might seem a little insulting and strange. You don't want your man saying you got bird eyes, but that's not really what he's saying. He's talking to her about loyalty. Watch this. The dove is an interesting bird. Here's why. The dove picks one mate for its whole lifetime. Did you know that? Another interesting thing about the dove is that its eyes are fixed in its socket. It can only look in one direction. So the brother is telling her, girl, I love you because I can tell that you are loyal and that you only have eyes for me. Talked about her eyes. Then he moves from her eyes to talking about her hair and that it looks good. He says, your hair is like a flock of goats coming down the mountain. Mash pause. And so during the week, I shared this text with Lady Baller, and she got to verse 1, and she said, oh, that's so sweet. He's talking about how she looks and how pretty her eyes are. And then she got to verse 2, and she said, hold up. Did he just say her hair looks like a goat? And so she was a little taken aback. Let me help you to understand something here. What he's saying is not that you look like a goat, but he's saying something a little bit more. So I want to help you to understand this word of affirmation. Check this out. Goats in that time were a symbol of wealth. Not only that, goats in the northern Palestinian area, they're called Syrian goats. They have black, silky hair. And so it was good. It was so good that even God said, when you make the curtains for the tabernacle, I want you to use goat's hair as the silk for it. He's saying, girl, not only do your eyes look good to me, but the way you work in your hair does something for me. Your hair is soft, black, and beautiful. Whether it's all yours and your natural or it's bundles, whatever it is, it looks good on you. I'm liking what you're doing. Then he begins to work his way down, affirming her beauty. He says, your teeth are white. And when he talks about twins, the type of animals he talked there, some research said that they are actually born in pairs. He's saying, your teeth are white and you ain't missing none. So he's saying, that's literally what he's saying. They all have a pair. That's what he's saying to her. I love your smile. And then she begins to respond a little bit. He says that your teeth and your temples are like pomegranates. She begins to blush a little bit. Watch this. He begins to work his way down, and he says, your neck is like the Tower of David, right there in verse 4. In this verse, he's really using what she's wearing to describe something about her. She would have been wearing a necklace with small round shields on it. So he compares those shields to the one that have been hung on the wall to protect the tower. He's letting her know that he sees something special in her. He sees characteristics of strength, characteristics of integrity. He's saying, it ain't just how you look that I like, but it's who you are that attracts me to you. At this point, you can imagine how the sister looks. She's looking real nice, and she's smiling a little bit because he's affirming her, and she's trying not to embarrass herself in front of everybody else that's there at the banquet. Listen, some people only feel love when you tell them positive things about themselves. Compliments are powerful communicators of love. Listen, if you are married to a person who needs words of affirmation, but you don't offer them, chances are you are actually hurting your spouse. When was the last time you looked at your spouse and told them how much you love them and what you love about them? When was the last time you called them in the middle of the day just to make them blush at work, to tell them how much you love them and what you love about them? When was the last time you wrote a little poem? You know, when you was dating, you made up stuff. When was the last time you wrote a little poem and just left it for them? And if you don't do it, check this out, somebody will. If you did it before you said I do, don't lose sight of it after you say I do. If you don't give words of affirmation, your chances are you're hurting your spouse and you're shaming them that you don't love them. Proverbs chapter 18, verse 21 says this, the tongue has the power of life and death. Words of affirmation don't have to be deep, y'all. It can be some simple things like, I like your hair like that, or that suit looks good on you. I do this all the time. I told Sister Ball this before sermon, that I do it all the time. I'm often reading a lot at school, and I'll be walking past reading a book, and she may be going to a meeting or something, and I'll stop, and I'll back up, and I'll stare, and she wants to know what's wrong with me. Is something all right? Everything all right? Yes, girl, you just caught my eye. I just wanted to look at you for a little. And I don't move. I just stand and I just look at her. And she thinks something is wrong with me. But what I am doing is letting her know I only have eyes for you. Girl, you still look good to me. Words of affirmation matter. And check this out, y'all. They're free. Somebody say free.
Free.
It'll cost you nothing. The brother in the text gives her words of affirmation. Girl, your eyes look good. Your hair look good. Glad you got all your teeth. Your lips look nice. Your neck says something about you. You can almost see her smiling, but he's not done yet. He's working his way down. In verse number 5, he looks past her neck and he says, girl, you're blessed. You're blessed. God has been good to you. Your chest, your breath is doing something for me. And then watch this. Verses 1 through 5, he's talking. He's giving words of affirmation. She's just listening. But when he starts working his way down, verse 6, she couldn't take it anymore. She said, wait, right there. She says, I will go down to the mountain of myrrh, to the hill of frankincense. Okay, y'all don't understand ancient Near Eastern coded language. Let me help you here. After he has affirmed her, she can't just sit quiet anymore. She says, look, sir, stop right there. Can we leave here? And can we go somewhere else to spend some quality time together? That's our second point, is simply this quality time. Right there, verses 6 through 8. Listen, they're at their wedding reception, and people are there having a good time, but he spoke a loving language to her, and now she's ready for some quality time. She's sitting and she's listening, but now she's saying, can we leave early? I want to go somewhere when we can be alone. Your mom and them ain't there. My mom and them ain't there. No kids running around. Your friends, your cousin, them. And can we just be left alone? Listen, we have a problem with this love language today. We tend to think that simply sitting next to each other is quality time, but it's not. There's a difference between an abundance of time and quality time. Can I get an amen? There is a difference between an abundance of time and quality of time. Brothers, you can be in the same room as your wife. You can be in the same house as your wife. But if you're watching the All-Star game, you may not even notice that your wife is there. That's not quality time. Sisters, you can be in the same room, same house as your wife. You can be a husband. You can be sitting right next to him. But if you're watching the newest season of Have and Have Nots, check this out. That's not quality time. You can be at a fancy restaurant with a white tablecloth with the waiter wearing a tuxedo and the food menu in French, and there is no price is there. But if you are checking Facebook trying to get an update on everybody else's posts, you're checking Instagram trying to see what everybody is, that's not quality time. Quality time is not just about being next to each other. It's about focusing on each other. It means that you're talking to each other and you're not interrupted. You're getting to talk about your future goals. You're talking about how you feel about each other. You're getting a chance to reminisce on your life experiences together. This is something that takes work and intentionality. A brother can put so much work into trying to make life better for his wife that he forget that he even has a wife. As a pastor, I've got to be honest and a little bit transparent here. For most pastors, this is something we often juggle because preachers have busy schedules to preach. Like last weekend, I had to preach after service here. Matter of fact, Sean and Elder Rawls came. I had to preach on Wednesday and Thursday night. We're always on the go. I'm lecturing in 2 weeks down in Virginia for a whole week. And so we're always on the go. January. In our doctoral cohort, one of the pastors, a friend of mine, told us a story because we had to do these surveys. The brother blessed everybody in class. We had to do these surveys, and we have to be very transparent and open with each other so we can strengthen one another. And one of the questions dealt with, how does your spouse feel about your schedule? And how does your spouse feel about your work in ministry? And I didn't know how to answer the question because there's times when my wife will sacrifice for me and say yes. And she may smile while doing it, and I may miss a cue. So brother, he answered the question. He said, y'all, my wife is here with me for school for these weeks. He said, listen, I want y'all to understand something. This isn't a vacation for us. I needed to do this. He said, I took on so many opportunities that looked great for my resume, but it was killing my marriage. And I had to begin to make a decision that some things I've got to say no to. Listen, my brothers and my sisters, when it comes to spending quality time together, there's some things you're going to simply have to say no to. Every now and then, you've got to make your relationship a priority. Tell some folks, no, you can't hang out. Put the phone down sometime. Get somebody else to watch the children. Go out and look into each other's eyes and talk about how much you love one another. Spend quality time together. Say these words. Words of affirmation.
Words of affirmation.
Quality time.
Quality time.
You see that in the text. And then thirdly, brothers and sisters, here's what we see. Physical touch. Physical touch. Right there in verses 9 through 16. Now that they're together, next chapter begins their physical touch. The next portion begins their physical touch. In verse 9, he says to her, You make my heart beat faster. You make my heart beat faster at just one look at you. Brothers, y'all missed it. I'll say it again. He said to her, girl, you make my heart beat faster. You make my heart beat faster at just one look at you. Y'all still missing. So let me break it down. Give you the Hebrew connotation, because again, I have to do my word research to make sure I'm understanding this. So let me give you a Hebrew connotation to help you to understand what this brother is saying in the text. You do know the function of the heart, don't you? You see, the heart, its function is to provide blood for your body. And when it beats faster, it sends a rush of blood to your body. Okay, y'all still look lost. He's saying to her, girl, I have been looking through your window from the outside of this wall for a long time. I have been singing to you, you've been singing to me for a long time. I couldn't wait to leave. And now that we are alone, I want you to know my heart is working real good and the blood is going to certain parts of my body. Girl, you do it. He's letting her know that right now is the moment. I don't need a blue pill or nothing else. I'm ready to go at this moment. That's what he's saying to her in the text. You can now pitch them alone. They got their quiet time. He begins to talk to her. He begins to say to her that you smell good. He said that your lips taste like honey, and underneath your tongue is like honey. And you've already seen them there engaged in kissing. They married at this time. Then the brother describes her by using metaphors like this. He describes her as a locked garden and as a sealed fountain. This is his way of saying to her, I know we're kissing and this looks real good, and I know that my heart is working. However, I'm not going to just take you. He begins to describe a list of spices in this garden to suggest to her that her garden is pleasurable to him, and he can find everything he needs in her garden. He ain't going to be bored in her garden. He's asking her to open up to pleasure him. Now listen, 5 times in this chapter, he's called her his bride. Single folk, don't try this at home or anywhere else. Married folk, y'all can try it whenever you want to. Her response is, y'all, this is amazing. She calls on two winds. This is amazing. It's amazing. I need you to get the picture here. She calls on the north wind and the south wind. This is amazing. She does not call on the east wind. Here's why. Genesis chapter 41, verse 6 lets us know that the east wind was known for storms. She don't call on the east wind. She don't call on the west wind because 1 Kings chapter 18, 44 lets us know that the west winds were described as rainy winds. So she don't call them those two. No. She calls them north wind and the south wind. She doesn't call on just one wind, but north and south. Why doesn't she just call on one? Because one would just blow something away. She don't want that. No. She calls on the north and the south wind to help her center what she's about to do. Can I just read the text to y'all? Because I don't have to say it in my words. Here's what she says. Verse number 16. Awake, O north wind, and come, wind of the south. Make my garden breathe out fragrances. Let its spices be wafted abroad. May my beloved come into his garden and eat its choice fruits. It's in the Bible, your text, my text. She's saying, come north wind, and come south wind and allow me to give all that I am to this man that has now wed himself to me. Okay, now there's something else that's important here. Watch this, brothers and sisters. We don't want to miss this. She is now opening up all that she is to him. And she's saying, I want my garden to always be something that he loves. Now watch this. This is important because you can't miss this aspect of it. If you're going to be a disciple of Jesus Christ, you got to understand this. I really want to talk to the brothers here. In order to get this physical sense of glory, you've got some responsibility. So normally I don't go to two major passages in the sermon, but for this one I want to help you understand something. Go to Ephesians chapter number 5. Ephesians chapter number 5. Everyone's going to put up on the screen for us. Ephesians chapter number 5, verse number 25. Ephesians chapter 5, verse number 25. Watch this. He's describing how Jesus loves the church, and he's describing it like the marriage in the text. Here's what he says. Husbands, love your wives just as Christ loved the church and gave himself up for her, so that he might sanctify her, having cleansed her by the washing of water with the word, that he might present to himself the church in all her glory, having no spot or wrinkle or any such thing, but that she would be holy and blameless. Here he is comparing the marriage relationship to the love that Jesus Christ has for the church. He says, husbands, love your wife like Christ loved the church. Watch this. The church is the bride. Christ is the bridegroom. Christ is the husband. The church is the wife. Brothers, listen to me. He's letting us know that we are supposed to be representatives of Christ in our home. And you can't be a representative of Christ in your home if you don't first have him in your life. So listen, we can't get this kind of openness without having the word of God and the spirit of God working in us. You are supposed to be the one washing her with the word. You ought to be the one getting up early in the morning and praying for her. And when she wakes up, say, girl, I woke up just to pray for you. You are on my mind. Take time to talk about the word of God with her. If you want this kind of openness in your marriage, you've got to be the ones who say, I'm applying godly principles, not street principles, to my marriage. Brothers, we have responsibility in this exchange. Okay, let's see if I can bring this full circle and I'm gonna let you go. Song of Solomon is a prophetic love story, a poetic love story between a man and really a country girl. Chapter 1, she describes how she don't feel good about herself, and she don't think much of herself, and uses exotic language to describe their love. It celebrates love and affection between a man and a woman, and it cuts across class barriers because these two should not even be together. And the question has to be asked, what did God intend when he inspired men to include this in the Old Testament canon? The great key to understanding this is understanding what's shown up in Ephesians chapter number 5 and how Jesus loved the church, how Jesus loves you and me. So we're talking about love languages. I want you to understand, my brothers and my sisters, Jesus exhibited all of the love languages for you and for me. Affirmation is one of the love languages, and Jesus was the one that lets us know that we are fearfully and wonderfully made. He wants you to know that you are somebody. He wants you to know that you are beautiful in his eyes. It's affirmation. Quality time, so much so that he came through 40 and two generations and walked the dusty streets for 33 years to let you know that he's willing to come where you are and to spend time with you. Acts of kindness. He's the one that opened blinded eyes. He's the one that made the lame walk and the dumb to talk. Acts of kindness. Physical touch. He was the one that would reach out and touch somebody to pick them up and to let them know that God loves them and cares about them when society has written them off. Not only he has affirmation, quality time, acts of kindness, and physical touch. The greatest one that I love is receiving gifts. He knew that to let you and I know that he loved us, he had to provide us with a gift. And he became the gift that we couldn't get anywhere else. So much so that he died on an old running cross to save you and to save me. He offered himself as a gift for us. And then early Sunday morning, he got all power in his hand to bless us with another gift. And that was a gift of salvation and eternal life. Our Lord and Savior exhibits all of the love languages to let you and me know that he loves us.
Amen.
my brothers and my sisters. You want a healthy marriage, you want a healthy relationship. The Song of Solomon teaches us words of affirmation are necessary. You may not be as poetic as this brother is. You may not talk about, you know, the goats coming down and patting her hair. You may not tell her she's got bird's eyes, but you ought to tell her something.
Yeah.
To let her know that you love her. You may, if your man needs words of affirmation, you ought to be able to tell him that he looks strong to you. Even if you got to embellish a little bit because they've been to a gym in a while, but you ought to be able to tell him that he looks right in that suit. It ought to be something to let him know that he's special in your eyes. Not only that, quality time really does matter. I know all of us are in the technology age, but we ought to put it down sometimes so we can spend time with one another. Not only do we spend quality time, but then there ought to be some physical attention, and the brother said, amen, I love that one. There ought to be some time we're spending our time physically together. The Bible lets us know that this is a healthy marriage, a healthy relationship. And Jesus Christ exhibits all of this to let us know that he loves us.
Yeah.
Let's pray. Lord God, thank you for the example that you've given us in Song of Solomon. Thank you, Lord God, that you allowed us to see it so that we don't have to take our cues from the world, but we can take our cues about healthy marriages from your word. Praying now, Lord God, for marriages. Praying, Lord God, for those that are in chapter 1 and chapter 2 of Song of Solomon that are looking to marriage. Praying now, Lord God, that you would help us be examples of godly relationships to the world. Praying now, Lord God, somebody who's heard this sermon, they've heard these love languages and they began to reflect on their past relationships and they feel as though they didn't get the affirmation. They feel as though they didn't get the quality time.